Welcome to Messiah Online. Thank you so much for joining us today. It's great to have you with us. We'd like for you to take a moment and register your attendance with us. Please just click on the icon there that's on your screen and let us know that you're worshiping today. And also, if you have any other needs or prayer requests, you can find the appropriate icon to click on there. One quick announcement coming up for our congregational partners in ministry. We have a congregational meeting on Sunday, June 2nd. At 11:30 a.m., and we're going to be electing our leaders for the coming year, going through the budget, ministry updates, and give you an update on the land sale. So we hope that you will be here 11:30 a.m. for our partners in ministry on June 2nd. And now let us begin our worship in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please join me in a word of prayer. Good and gracious God, as we gather here today to worship you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit on Pentecost Sunday, we ask you to give us vision. Move us by your Holy Spirit, whose very breath gives us life. Allow your Spirit to blow freely in and through us, as well as in and through our gathering with others. May we experience your mighty winds, clearing away our disbelief, our reluctance, our ambivalence, leaving only the full knowledge that we are your precious creation, your deeply loved children. Through your Spirit this day, bring hope and good news to us all. Bring freedom and peace to broken people, and let us get a taste of heaven right here on earth. Come, Holy Spirit, come and fill us to overflowing to the praise of you, our God, and for the blessing of our neighbors. And all God's children say, amen.
As heaven and earth sing, holy is.
Bible reading for this morning comes from the Gospel of Matthew, the 28th chapter, verses 16 through 20. And this is known as the Great Commission. Now, the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. And when they saw him, they worshipped him, but they doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always to the end of the age." The Gospel of our Lord. And now, Pastor Jay.
Siblings in Christ, grace and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. "I'll Be There," the first single from the Jackson 5's third album, literally titled Third Album, was released on the day before Michael Jackson's 12th birthday in August of 1970. It went to number one on both the Billboard Hot 100 and Soul Singles charts and hit number four in the UK. The song was co-written by several established songwriters and record producers, including Motown owner Berry Gordy Jr. and producer Hal Davis. Because the Funk Brothers, they're the session musicians who regularly worked for Motown, hadn't yet relocated to Los Angeles from Detroit, the track was recorded with LA-based studio musicians, including keyboardist Joe Sample of the Jazz Crusaders. Michael Jackson shared lead vocals with his older brother, Jermaine. The song was the Jackson 5's biggest hit, and it was also a critical success. Following the group's earlier hits, I Want You Back, ABC, and The Love You Save, I'll Be There, it solidified the Jackson 5's careers, and it showed audiences that the group had potential beyond bubblegum pop. A reviewer in Stereo Gum put it this way: "I'll Be There is an almost painfully adult song, a song about regret and longing and warmth and support and mixed up feelings. And Jackson sings it with an almost absurd grace, a sense of empathy and tenderness and understanding. He was doing this at an age," writes this reviewer, when I was eating entire cans of frosting that I'd stolen from my parents' pantry." According to a review in AllMusic, commenting on Michael's vocals, "Rarely, if any, had one so young sung with so much authority and grace, investing this achingly tender ballad with wisdom and understanding far beyond his years." Record World said that the change of pace, using a slower tempo than their earlier hits, showcases the group's versatility. A duet version of the song by Mariah Carey and Trey Lorenz was released in 1992, and that became her sixth straight number one hit. The song was inducted into the Grammy Hall of Fame in 2011. The song, "I'll Be There," is a pledge to support and comfort another person, no matter what happens. In the third verse, we realize that the song is about the singer's ex, and the singer is promising that he'll drop everything and come running whenever his former love gets lonely. That line transforms it from a song of friendship into a song of heartbreak. But the first two verses and the chorus remind me of what Jesus says at the end of Matthew's gospel, and what the Bible tells us about the Holy Spirit. Listen to these lines from the song. "Where there is love, I'll be there. Just call my name, I'll be there. I'll be there to comfort you. I'll be there with a love that's strong. I'll be your strength. Let me fill your heart with joy and laughter. Whenever you need me, I'll be there. I'll be there to protect you. Just call my name and I'll be there." And I could have gone on. That's just some of those lines with that kind of feeling. Now, as we were going through songs and identifying which ones we'd use for our Gospel Rock series this year, I couldn't help but think of the last line of Matthew's Gospel, where Jesus says to his disciples, "And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age." The context, as Matthew tells the story, is that the disciples have gone to Galilee, where the risen Jesus had instructed Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to tell the disciples to go meet him. And the disciples went, probably not knowing whether the women's words were true, setting out on an unknown journey into an unknown future with only a word. Well, this characterizes what it means to be a disciple, a follower of Jesus. Jesus does meet the disciples in Galilee, as he has promised, but the response is mixed. Some worship him, but some doubt. Now, you might have expected that upon encountering the risen Lord Jesus, the response would have been clearer. But as New Testament scholar Craig Kaster points out, a mixture of faith and doubt also characterizes discipleship. Danish philosopher Soren Kierkegaard, who trained to be a Lutheran pastor, then spent his career writing, calls attention to the need for a leap of faith, because we can never be 100% certain. We can't prove it. So faith is required, even as doubt is sometimes the flip side of faith. And we understand this from our own experience. We are called to go. We're called to go to where Jesus will meet us. We're directed to places and experiences where we will have the opportunity to meet the living, risen Christ. We hope to encounter the presence of God, the presence of Jesus in worship, prayer, or in service to others, for example. Yet, we might wonder if it's true. Maybe it's the hope that the message is true and that participating in a community of believers where Jesus promises to meet people, promises to be present for us, maybe it's that we hope we might meet him and he'll meet us as well. Then Jesus sends this group of disciples who don't have it all together out to make other disciples. Now, this might not seem like a great plan, but God uses imperfect people. Why does God use imperfect people? Because that's the only kind of people there are, right? And these imperfect disciples whom Jesus instructs to go are in no position to make themselves the object of faith. That is part of the good news. The invitation is not to follow some particular pastor, some particular politician, or some would-be prophet. No, the invitation is to follow Jesus. And following Jesus means learning to obey his commands, to follow his teachings. Now, we will do this imperfectly, but we are called to strive to live in accordance with Jesus' commands, his teachings, which are completely countercultural in today's secular, materialistic, consumer-driven culture. No one can make anyone follow Jesus. What the disciples have and what we have is the word from the living, risen Jesus Christ that invites us to follow. And Jesus promises to be with us always. How does this work? The good news, according to Matthew, gives us several examples, including, as we see in Matthew 1, verse 23, Jesus will be called Emmanuel, which means God with us. Jesus is God's presence, and he is the best revelation that we have of what God is like. In Matthew chapter 10, verse 40, Jesus sends his disciples out, saying that whoever receives or welcomes his disciples also receives or welcomes him. Jesus is present with us through the presence of other believers. Those of us who are following Jesus are collectively the body of Christ on this earth, and we encounter Jesus through relationships with each other. In Matthew chapter 18, verse 20, Jesus tells his disciples that where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there among them. The church here is assured of the continued presence of Jesus as we carry out his mission to work for the kingdom of God and to teach people to follow Jesus' commands, which are really good advice about what living in the kingdom of God on this earth looks like. We encounter Jesus when we worship, when we study the Bible, or serve together, for example. Martin Luther defined the church as people who gather together for worship, and one of the ways we encounter the presence of God, the presence of Jesus in this world, is by attending worship. And Jesus is present with us through the Holy Spirit. In John chapter 20, beginning at verse 21, as Jesus is meeting his disciples on the evening of the first Easter Sunday, Jesus said, and here I'm using N.T. Wright's suggested translation, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you tell anyone of the forgiveness of sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not tell them, they are not forgiven." We are sent on a mission. Just as God the Father sent Jesus on a mission to teach us what living in the kingdom of God looks like, and then die and rise, defeating the power of evil, we are called to be on a mission from God. To love the world like God loves the world, including loving the people in the world who are opposed to God and God's values. And we're called to tell people of the offer of forgiveness and how Jesus sets us free from the power of sin, including our own failures. How Jesus sets us free from that power, as well as the power of death and the power of evil in this world. And the Holy Spirit, who is the Spirit of Christ, the primary way we encounter the presence of Jesus in this world, accompanies us on this mission. In addition to referring to the Spirit of Christ, Paul sometimes calls the Holy Spirit the Spirit of Jesus Christ, the Spirit of Jesus, or the Spirit of the Son. Jesus is indeed the giver of the Holy Spirit, who is Jesus' continued presence in the world. In Acts 2, verse 33, in Peter's speech on the day of Pentecost, we read that Jesus, in fact, has poured out the Holy Spirit. "Therefore, being exalted to the right hand of God," Peter says, "and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he poured out this which you now see and hear." We Lutheran Christians claim to believe in the Trinity, that God consists of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. One God in three persons or faces, perhaps. The easiest way to understand the Trinity is to simply say that there are three different ways in which God relates to the world. And this isn't the whole story, but it's a good start at understanding the Trinity. We might say, for example, that God the Father is the creator and the provider, that God the Son, Jesus, is the one who redeems us, and the Holy Spirit is the one who sanctifies us or makes us holy. In practice, however, like many Western Christians, we tend to put much more emphasis on the Father and the Son than on the Holy Spirit. The typical college or seminary level theology textbook is about this thick, and the first almost half of it is about God the Father. The second almost half of it is about God the Son, and there are a few pages at the end as if apparently when they were almost done, they said, "Oh, we can't write a book this big." Just a few pages at the end about the Holy Spirit. So it's worth spending at least a little bit of time today talking about who the Holy Spirit is and what the Holy Spirit does for us. When we say the creed, we say, "I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic," that's Catholic with a small c, "Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body and the life everlasting. What do we mean by that? Well, for starters, the Holy Spirit makes us holy. Other kinds of spirits are referenced in the Bible, such as the human spirit, heavenly spirits, and even evil spirits. But only God's Spirit is called the Holy Spirit. How does this process of making us holy, sometimes referred to as being sanctified, take place? You might think the Creed doesn't actually tell us much about the Spirit, and then goes on to mention these other things. But the other things, the communion of saints, the church, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection and everlasting life, are a list, admittedly a partial list or description, of ways in which the Spirit works to make us holy. We are led into a holy community, into the church, where we hear the word of God and are brought to faith in Christ. This is the work of the Holy Spirit. As we read in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, no one can say Jesus is Lord except by the power of the Holy Spirit. When we worship, when we gather together, we hear the word of God read and proclaimed. We pray, we sing songs of praise and worship. We sing hymns. We receive the presence of Jesus through receiving the Lord's Supper, also known as communion. And when we do all those things, the Holy Spirit is at work in us to bring us to faith or to strengthen our faith. As Martin Luther pointed out in his large catechism, where Christ is not preached, there is no Holy Spirit to create, call, and gather the Christian church, apart from which no one can come to our Lord Christ. We are brought into the true church by the Holy Spirit, and the Spirit is always with us as the presence of Christ. We learn of and experience forgiveness because of the work of the Spirit as we hear and have the opportunity to respond to the good news. And because we are never completely without sin, we are always in need of this forgiveness. Through the Holy Spirit, we are made holy. We are made right with God. And our holiness is increased when we spend time in spiritual practices that bring us into contact with Jesus and his Spirit. By teaching us the good news of Jesus, the Holy Spirit is at work to bring us to faith, then to continue the lifelong process of increasing this holiness in us, being the presence of Christ in us so that we may become little Christs to our neighbors, sharing with them the love of God so that they may also experience the presence of Jesus Christ, who is always with us. Thanks be to God. Now I ask you to join me as we confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Champion of God. Oh, keep the torch. Keep the torch. Okay. I will be a champion of God. I will. Ooh. Ooh. Okay. Gotta train. Oh, here we go. Must be strong. I can do it. Oh, champion of God. Here we go. Whew, this is tough. Whew. I'm going to do this. Man, God, I really wish someone was here to help me. I got to be an Olympic athlete. Champion of God, I need your help here. Whew, being an Olympic athlete is tough. I really need some trainers. I really wish I had a trainer or a guide or a helper. I hear Messiah is doing Vacation Bible School, July 15th through the 19th, and we need leaders. I need a leader. I need a trainer. I need to be a champion of God. We need your help. There's a lot of possibilities this year. We're looking for someone to coordinate our snacks. We're looking for someone to coordinate team building, my favorite, and to lead in several ways, walking with our children, helping in our classrooms, so many opportunities. Teenagers, adults, anyone, we'd love to have you there. Let's do this together. Let's win the gold. Let's be champions of God together. We encourage you to sign up today on the website. Children, we'd love to have you here this summer, July 15th through the 19th. And all those volunteers, I would love to have this opportunity to work with you.
Thank you, Cassandra. We do need volunteers, volunteers who are champions. You know, great athletes require great coaches, and we need great coaches for our VBS teams. We need you, you, the Olympic caliber lovers of Jesus, to shine and to spread the joy to others. So sign up today, and let's bring home the gold, because we cannot do this without you. We're going to have a blast for the week of Vacation Bible School. Love to have you on our team. We move now into our time of offering. Please join me in a word of prayer. Generous God, on this Pentecost Sunday, we joyfully bring our offerings before you. Just as the first disciples were transformed by the power of your Spirit, we pray that our gifts would be used to further the work of your kingdom. May your Holy Spirit keep us attuned to the voices all around us, to those who need us, to be bearers of your love and compassion. And may these gifts which we share help us through your church meet the needs of others. In the holy name of Jesus, and all God's children say, amen. Just want to remind you that there's lots of ways that we have to give here at Messiah. You can give online. You can give through the text, the number that's on the screen there. You can go through automated giving in your bank. You can mail in your offerings or drop them off here at the church. No matter how you choose to give and whatever you give, we want to say a special thank you for partnering with us to bring that love, that hope, and the compassion of Jesus to a world in need. And now, once again, please join me in a word of prayer. Amazing God, you call us today and every day, just as you called the disciples on the day of Pentecost. You challenge and support us, revealing the brokenness of our communities, giving us the peace that our world needs. You point us to the pain of the cross and then remind us of the joy of the resurrection. Transform us, O God, through the power of your Holy Spirit. Help us to breathe deeply the breath of life. Blow through each of us and change our lives forever. And now we join together in praying the prayer that you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. His glory on display.
Receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you with grace and with mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace. Serve the Lord with joy. Thanks be to God.